Hello, Uggies Worldwide. I'm Dave Kessler, amateur radio call sign KE0OG, here with another episode of Ask Dave. This is one that I think will be of particular interest. In it, we're going to talk about nuclear high-altitude electromagnetic pulse. This is a topic of a lot of interest among a lot of people. And so, this being Ask Dave, we're going to start with the question and work our way through actually a bunch of charts and walk away with kind of what I know at the end. Now, I know that a lot of you out there know more about this than I do, and I would like you to correct me or add information. You can do it in the comments. The form it should take is to tell me exactly where in the video the problem was, minutes and seconds, and then tell me what I said wrong, what it should be, and what your source is for saying that, okay? Because this is a complex topic. Much of it is classified, and so I have no access to it. So let's jump in and take a look. We're just going to jump right into these charts. Nuclear high-altitude electromagnetic pulse. Now, the sources I used for this are these, DHS document, DOE document, DOD document here. DOE, by the way, the Department of Energy, is the one that manages the nation's stockpile of nuclear bombs. Now, there's also Paratini et al. This is a paper in Advanced Electromagnetics that talks about EMC pulses. And one of the great things it has here is it shows shows it in the frequency domain. Wikipedia, of course, numerous articles on high-altitude nuclear EMP. I used a lot of that. Now, here's a source I wish I had, Mill Standard 2169C Notice 1. Unfortunately, it's secret. It is the DoD's explanation of the high-altitude electromagnetic pulse environment, and it is kept current. So this is something that, I wish I could see. Now, here's the original question that prompted my digging into this. This comes from David Martin. No call is given. I tried to look up David Martin in QRZ and found that there are 143 of them. And you can't really search on an email in QRZ. At least I haven't figured out how to do that. So you can search on names, you can search on lots of things, but not emails. Now his question is this: are there any transceivers on the market today that would survive high altitude nuclear electromagnetic pulse from an atom bomb, or can a vacuum tube radio survive that? The short answer is this: like lightning resiliency, the entire system, meaning the antenna, transmission line, grounding, and electronic equipment, can help provide resiliency. The long answer? Well, read on. I'd like to introduce you to a place. It's out in the middle of the Pacific, and it's about as much in the middle of the Pacific as it can get. This area here would be in the middle of the Pacific. It's Johnston Atoll, and it was for years in the 50s and 60s an active center for the testing of atomic bombs, and they use little islands all over here, all over everywhere. This is where they shot off the weapons that gave us the information we have about electromagnetic pulse today. This is the second one, actually. I don't have a picture of the first. Hardtack 1 Teak. The name of the test was Teak. Hardtack 1 was the collection of tests that they did. The 1st of August, 1958. 3.8 megatons, okay, 34 kilometers above the surface of the Earth, part of Operation Newsreel. Okay, I don't know why they used the term newsreel, since they weren't giving this to the news. The one side effect that I've been able to find from that particular test was there was an electromagnetic pulse observed at the Apia Observatory at Samoa that was four times any solar storm that they'd ever seen. Here's another one from that early group of tests, Hardtack 1, Orange, Operation Newsreel. Certainly colorful. It can be easily seen from the ground. Now, you might ask, what's up there to ignite? Well, this is actually the airglow of the pieces of the bomb itself. Okay, the bomb explodes, and the casing, all the other material that's vaporized, is heated extremely, and you get a fairly wild picture like this. So yes, if you do ignite an atomic weapon in space, you are going to see it. In fact, here is from another series of tests called Operation Fishbowl, and a series called Starfish. They sent up a starfish, it failed. So the next one was Starfish Prime. The next one after that, they had a double prime and a triple prime. So anyway, it was on the 20th of June in 1962. This is 1.4 megatons at 400 kilometers and was seen from Hawaii, okay, as a very bright light. Now, Starfish Prime had a lot of side effects. First of all, I should mention, if you are on a Johnston Atoll, where these rockets were launched, they were launched at an angle, so they would not have exploded directly over Johnston Island. And this one, you can see it from Hawaii. It damaged electronics in Honolulu, New Zealand, fused 300 streetlights on Oahu. I assume that means fused them by shorting them. Set off about 100 burglar alarms, which in a city it back then probably 100, 200,000, it was certainly not all of them. There was the failure of a microwave repeater on Kauai. Not all of them, one of them. Now, this is in some ways more important. It produced an artificial radiation belt. And there was absolutely nothing up there at that altitude to stop this radiation belt from distributing itself all the way around the Earth. It destroyed three satellites outright, Ariel, Track, and Transit B. It damaged three satellites, Cosmos 5, Engine 1, and Telstar 1. Damage meant, for example, a reduction in the ability to produce power from the sun, or damaging power amplifiers to give it less output, and so on. Now, 4 months after this, NASA expressed concern. Remember, this is when we are doing our very first flight tests of people in space. NASA was concerned because 4 months after the explosion, the radiation dose was greater than 0.6 gray per day for a well-shielded capsule in polar orbit. So, for example, if this is in polar orbit, it's going to go over the South Pole, then the North Pole, South Pole, North Pole. So in one transit, which for the altitudes that they were at here, would have been several times a day. Now, gray is a total dose of radiation. Okay, for example, a pelvic CT scan is 6 milligrays, and that's a total dose. And so the total dose per day, per person, was 0.6 grays. Notice that is 100 times. They were concerned that their astronauts were going to get fatal doses of radiation. It gradually dissipated. And they discovered that the effective satellite outright kill radius was about 80 kilometers, which is not huge in outer space. Now, in this period of time, there were about 80 total satellites in orbit, 80, okay? And compare that today. I wanted to introduce you to another location. This is Kapustin Yar, which is a place in the Soviet Union out in the desert, away from people, not nearly as away from people as Johnston Atoll, but out in the desert. And this is where they fired theirs. And they could fire out this way if they wanted to or whatever. The Soviet test effects, this is all I can find that showed, you know, the total of the test effects. They had a number of tests too. The EMP fused 570 kilometers of overhead telephone lines with a measured current of 2,500 amps. Now, I don't know how they did overhead telephone lines in those days, whether they did them like telegraph lines or whether they did some kind of a cable, I don't know. It also, because of the conducted EMP on the power lines, it started a fire that actually burned down the Karaganda power plant. It shut down 1,000 kilometers of shallow buried power cables between these two places, which I will not attempt to pronounce. Now, this is an eye chart. It's a list from Wikipedia of known nuclear high altitude explosions. And we've got Hardtack 1, which was Operation Newsreel, USA Argus, which was in the South Atlantic Ocean. The Soviet Union tested at Kapustin Yar. The USA exploded at Johnston Atoll again. And here's your Starfish Prime. So you've got Bluegill failed, Bluegill Prime failed, Bluegill Double Prime failed, but Bluegill Triple Prime, they got to go. Starfish failed, but Starfish Prime, got to give these guys credit. They keep going. 9 July 1962, 1.4 megatons at 400 kilometers. It's up there pretty high. Okay, now I want you to notice the dates on these next six. Checkmate, Kingfish, and Tightrope were in 1962 in October, and then in November right afterwards. So these went up pretty quickly. The Soviet Union Project K, Kapustin Yar, put up two in October of 1962, 184, 187, and 195. Isn't it interesting that there was a lot of these things being tested around, before, or after October of that year? So what happened in that October? Well, the Cuban Missile Crisis happened. That's what happened. This was from October 16th to October 29th, 1962. I remember going with my father down to the grocery store to buy a few of what he called essentials, because he, like everybody else in the United States, was stocking up on food, and we were stripping shelves bare. And he told me, now, don't tell the clerk that we're stocking up. And I said, okay. And so Dad proceeded to try and persuade the clerk that this was normal shopping. She didn't buy a bit of it. And I don't know why my dad wanted to hide it. Everybody was stocking up for that. So what happened that October is we had the Cuban Missile Crisis. People are aware of what happened. We had deployed missiles in Italy and Turkey, so the Soviet Union deployed missiles close to the U.S. and Cuba. And this was John F. Kennedy's probably biggest foreign policy test. Russia finally blinked and backed down, but it's not well known that during that period of time, there were a whole bunch of these high-altitude EMPs. They were doing what is euphemistically called saber rattling. Saber rattling was each tried to prove to the other side that they had a bigger missile, I guess. That was part of that crisis. Okay, now let's turn to find out what is high altitude nuclear electromagnetic pulse. First of all, nuclear scientists have been aware of EMP from very early days, before they did the exo-atmospheric tests. The extensive test data was gathered during all the tests, but especially on EMP during the space tests. The summation of all of this is distilled in that classified document, MIL Standard 2169. Now, there is lots of generalized info readily available, Wikipedia and much more. There's all kinds of stuff available. It all traces back to those tests that were done back in the late 50s and early 60s until there was a space weapons treaty that was signed. And there was about the same time out there, they were working on atmospheric test bans, which is probably a good idea because we were really polluting our atmosphere, something horrible with all this fallout. Now, there's lots of folklore out there, too, some of it truly imaginative. I once heard a guy tell another ham at one of our ham radio club meetings that EMP can leap 6 feet. And I went, what? I tried to get them to tell me where they'd got that info, but they acted as though this was secret info, not something they could share with a poor guy like me. Well, one of the problems we're going to discover with this is that the actual pulse is not very long, and it does not travel very far during the entire pulse. Well, I'll show it to you. Let's look at here. Okay, this is from a DOD, or Nuclear Environmental Survivability Report by the Army back in 1994. Anyway, the high altitude burst sends gamma rays, who seem to cause most of the problem. Now, the gamma rays hit electrons. Now, these very highly energized electrons think of magnetic field lines, which is a way of demonstrating the electromagnetic field. And the electron will spiral around it as it travels. You've got a moving electric field in a magnetic field. And so what are you going to get? You're going to get an electromagnetic field that radiates from here. And this is the electromagnetic pulse. Why a pulse? Because it only lasts for a short period of time. It's not something that's a wave that rattles back and forth. It's a one-time shot. Now, the value of this can be very high. If you explode a nuclear weapon over, say, North Dakota, up toward the ionosphere, in the ionosphere, you're going to get your worst electromagnetic pulse down here at about 50,000 volts per meter and 37,000 out here, even 25,000 volts per meter way out here. So one bomb can provide this very significant pulse over like the entire United States. This is the graph that you usually see in an EMP document. It's divided into three parts. E1, early time. This is from the prompt gamma signal. E2, intermediate time, from the scattered gamma signal and the neutron gamma signal. And then late time, the magnetic disturbance of the high altitude. Now, this is on a logarithmic scale. We can see this. We understand this. 10 to the 0 is 1 volt per meter. Then you've got 10 to the 1th, which is 10 volts per meter, 100 volts per meter, and you know, these go up in twos here, which is unfortunate. They're not using engineering notation. If they were, it'd be factors of 3 up here. 10 to the 0, 10 to the 3, 10 to the 6, and so on. Now, the thing that's important about this chart is the time scale. The time scale goes with time forward, okay? But look, 10 to the 0 seconds is 1 second. So this is 10 to the 1th or 10 seconds. 10 to the 2th, which is 100 seconds, and then 1,000 seconds. Now look as it goes backwards. 10 to the minus 3 is a millisecond. 10 to the minus 6 is a microsecond. 10 to the minus 9th is a nanosecond. A nanosecond. Light travels more than a foot in a nanosecond. So light's not traveling very far. Now, I dug through, if we look at this, early time, if you go about 10 to the minus 6, this is microseconds, here's nanoseconds, somewhere in here is where your gas discharge lightning stuff is going to fire, right here. E1 is early time. E2 is like lightning, but more so. Okay? Like lightning, but more so. It lasts quite a period of time here. Okay? Up to here, this last part, it's about 10 to the minus 3, which is a millisecond. We know how to deal with lightning, so I'm not going to talk about this more. Late time, E3, is on the many seconds range, up to here's 10 to the 3, or 1 kilosecond. Okay? Now, the thing is, these are for the people who have long wires, like the electric grid and stuff like that. And that affects things like that. Okay? E1, however, is something that we really don't have anything to deal with. Now, like I said, the gas discharge tubes take about 300 or so nanoseconds to fire, so that's somewhere in this range, while this thing is already starting to trail off. Now, these people have separated out and made a Model 4, the E1 pulse. This is E1. There's actually a formula for it here in terms of volts per meter. And these right here, 4 times 10 to the 7th per second, mean these are in units of either hertz or radians per second, okay? And they've got all kinds of factors, and you can play with that. Now, just for fun, dare I ask how much energy is in E1? Remember, E1 goes out from the blast like a blast wave, a very brief blast wave. It is about, up to a microsecond, but really more in the nanosecond region, okay? So it's extremely fast. The actual pulse travels, this is about a nanosecond, so if you take nanoseconds, it's about from here to the wall. That's how wide the pulse is. And it goes zinging by us at the speed of light. So it's like a bubble, a soap bubble coming out. The pulse is only on the soap bubble. Inside, there's nothing. Now, can it reflect off of things? Yes, of course it can do. All the things an electromagnetic energy can do. Now, dare I ask how much energy is in E1? Let's say 50 kilovolts per meter. Okay, now to get the energy, we're going to need a resistance. We're not in coax here, we're in air. So 377 ohms is approximately the ratio between the electric wave and the magnetic wave, and therefore is the impedance of air. This gives E squared over R, which is power, is 6.6 times 10 to the 6, or 6.6 million watts per meter squared. But now this is just power, and it only flashes for a little bit. I'm going to give it 30 nanoseconds. So we've got 6.6 E6 watts per meter squared times 30 nanoseconds. We're going to get the watts times time to get watt seconds. 0.2 milliwatt seconds per meter squared. That's how much power is in this pulse per meter squared. A milliwatt second. There's no point in converting that to milliwatt hours, because as soon as we get this, after about 30 nanoseconds, the E1 pulse is gone. Okay, so we need to protect against a high voltage for very short periods of time with that doesn't have enough energy to destroy discrete components. I won't argue about destroying chips, things like that, which really can't handle this much power. But if there's something around it, a shield or a filter or something like that. But when you start talking about filters, we're talking about the frequency range. So what is the frequency range of this pulse? This is where that article comes in for that electromagnetic journal. This is your standard E1 curve here, okay. And they did a bunch of math and a bunch of testing and so on. And they've got a number for alpha, a number for beta, and no elevation here, but it starts out steady from zero up to alpha. Remember, this is a one-time pulse. If it were a repeating pulse, it would have its basic fundamental frequency at the pulse repetition rate, and then it would have quite a spread of harmonics. But this is a one-time pulse. You need to go all the way back to DC and out for quite a ways. What's alpha? Well, we look in all their tables here and so on, and come to find out they've got E1, E2, and a bell type thing here. But we're looking for E1 and E2. And alpha for E1, okay, 4E7. Now, why can't they use engineering units? That's 40 E6. And here's 600 E6. And that's in seconds, except that this is in omega. Omega is radians per second. And you can convert that to frequency by multiplying by 2 pi. So I've got kind of a rough approximation here. The voltage of and against omega down here, I'm going to go hertz. We're going to go hertz. This is going to be 250 megahertz. Minus 20 dB per decade, and don't forget that that's for omega. So every time omega goes up by a factor of 10, a decade is a factor of 10, this pulse comes down 20 dB. You've got to convert that to hertz. I did not do that. But look at this, flat out to 250 megahertz, and then it starts to go away. Okay, so now we know a little bit about our pulse. So how can we protect our stuff? We can't rely on gas discharge tube technology. Gas discharge tubes, like are in all lightning arresters, in the Alpha Delta lightning arrester, the gas discharge tube is the only element of the lightning arrester. But they take 100 nanoseconds to start conducting, meaning arcing over. And by then, the pulse is gone, okay? So we have to use some sort of reactive components, inductance and capacitance, in other words. Now, here's the issue. Remember that what looks like an inductor at HF frequencies can act like a capacitor at VHF and vice versa. Oh my goodness. We need a component that has, you know, that behaves all the way up to 250 megahertz and above. And then how do you test it? Where do you generate a E1 wave? How do you do that? I don't find that anywhere in the literature. Even this paper that was right up here was, they did something that was scaled time-wise and worked back to get the frequency domain. Now, in addition, remember your antenna is likely resonant at the desired frequency, so it will only pick up some of the energy. You know, the 100 kilohertz energy that's going by your 40 meter dipole is not going to excite much of a response. Now, I don't have the answers, but one company claims to. This is something called EMP Shield. Okay. EMP protection, all phases of an EMP, E1, E2, and E3. Well, E2 is lightning, like lightning, only more so. And E3 is that long, drawn-out pulse that you get there. Now, the lightning protection is backed up by a $25,000 insurance policy, 100% lightning guarantee. Boy, that sure is different from my experience, which is that a direct strike, which I've had, all bets are off. And then solar flare protection. This is the E3 type stuff. This is the kind of thing where you build up a lot of current and voltage on your transmission lines. Now, today's equipment is designed to kick off before enough energy can be induced in it to damage it. Okay. Now, the EMP, again, there's not that much energy in that pulse. The long power lines are not really sensitive to waves at 250 gigahertz. They resonate down in the tens of hertz, okay? But they claim this. Okay, for $379, which is four times what it costs for a normal ham radio style lightning arrestor, they have this thing called the EMP Shield, and it's model ANT1500N. I presume this has got N connectors. I presume they're one for amateur use. Has got UHF connectors, but you can also get adapters. And then look at this dinky little ground thing here. If I were to hold up a lightning arrestor, this one by Alpha Delta right here, okay, it's got the little gas discharge tube in here. But look at the size of the lug, and it's supposed to be connected right here to a holder that connects it to the ground rod. This is designed to be supported by its connection to the ground rod. Clearly, this one isn't. You've got to attach a strap or something like that. Now, I was highly curious how they approached E1. So, I gave them a call and talked with a very eager salesman on the end of the line. And I says, how do you approach E1? Well, that's proprietary. And we talked about this. He says, they're not going to release that information. It's got to be some combination of reactive elements, because otherwise they wouldn't react enough. I mean, reactants, there is a speed of light phenomenon going through the reactants, but still, it's going to act as a reactance. You can short it with a capacitor, or you could delay it with an inductor. As you get up into the higher frequencies, you can put other stuff in there to handle that. But he would not tell me how they approached E1. Then he said, we have patents, you know. I says, can you give me a patent number? Notice that this one just says patented, but it doesn't say what the patent numbers are. So I told the guy, he says, you're giving me a great big giant trust me card. Now, in DoD circles, a trust me card is when a salesman tells you, I'm not going to tell you how it works, but it works. That's a trust me card. He's handing the card that says, trust me, I know. Well, I don't. I'm sorry, I don't trust them. Until you can show to me how you approach E1, I don't believe you. Okay? You have to show me. Now, if somebody out there knows the patent numbers for this thing, please let me know. Now, I'm going to turn to a different my last thing to talk about, and that is the last temp event was in 1962. Will it ever happen again? Now, this we get into the classic military argument of, do we look at their capability or do we look at their intentions? How do we put those together? France and England have nuclear weapons. Okay, France has the Ariane rocket series. The Indians have nuclear weapons, the Pakistanis. Several nations have this capability, but none have tested it in space. So, intentions, capabilities. Do we have the capability to do something? Well, a lot of people have the capability to do some very nasty things. But do we judge their intentions such that we are their allies, their friends, work with them hand in glove, whatever? That is an age-old military planning conundrum. In the 1960s, only the U.S. and the USSR had the capability. Now several other nations have this capability. And I'm going to make this very bold statement here. It is in nobody's self-interest to create a high-altitude nuclear EMP event, because if they do so, they're shooting themselves in the foot. The world has come to rely on electronics. Now, a lot of that electronics is harder than you think it is. Maybe not your consumer equipment, but by the time you're talking about power lines and stuff like that, it's pretty sophisticated, okay? Now, I want to just look at satellites in the air. Remember in 1962, there were on the order of 100 satellites. In 2023, we are looking at over 7,000. And some companies are adding to that number regularly. Now, I want to show you a little bit of video. Okay, what I'm showing you is recent dramatization or kind of a view of where the satellites are around the world. Now, one source tells me this is the orbital debris. Another source tells me this is the active satellites. But you can see up here the geostationary satellites, sometimes known as the Arthur C. Clarke orbit. Now, here we come down here and look at all the satellites. If you chucked up an EMP, you're going to destroy a subsection of those, which is going to be quite a few of them. And you're going to damage other satellites. And now this thing is going to show you, this again is the geostationary band of satellites. We're going to go over and look at the South Pole. Now, here's the South Pole, and here's something interesting. Here are the orbits of what are so-called sun-synchronous satellites. That is, as they go around the Earth, they hit the same spot on the Earth at the same time every day. Okay, look, just look at that. It's absolutely crazy, all of the satellites that are up there. If we started playing in outer space, we'd have a problem. Now, I want to point out that some years ago, the Chinese did a satellite kill test, and they went up in the 200-mile range and killed a satellite, broke it into many, 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 many bits and pieces. Now, the problem with that is that those pieces are up there. They will not fall out of orbit anytime soon, hundreds of years. And they just act as debris that could kill other satellites. It was terribly irresponsible. I have a few finishing thoughts. I have lightning arresters on everything. That's going to probably take care of E2, and it's up to the utilities to take care of E3. I want to point this next one out. If there is a hemp event, we have much bigger problems. We are at war, nuclear war, okay? And whether or not your equipment survives so that you can check into your local net isn't going to help you much. The whole country's got a problem. We need to be better organized, like with ARES or ACES or OXCOM or whatever your local agency calls it, so that we can help. It's probably largely going to be done on VHF, although there will be some longer haul stations. We need to worry about disasters that already happen all too frequently. Fires, floods, tornadoes, hurricanes, the list goes on and on. I, for one, plan to sleep soundly tonight. So there you have it. I've gone into a lot of detail. This has been a long video to talk about hemp and give you some actual technical background on what's going on, so you've got additional vocabulary to talk about it and so on. I will state right now that I think E1 is an unsolved problem for small radios and things like that. If you have a low-pass filter in your system and it's really sturdy, it could probably siphon off the bulk of those waves. Roofing filters can do the same. So the actual energy in the pulse is tiny. It just comes so fast that it's going to get through any of our defenses. And there are chips. You get on a chip with that kind of energy, you can actually cause some damage. So be careful. So there you have it. If you would like to help support this channel, go to dkassler.com/support. And I want to say 73, and we're going to show you a list of our patrons. Thank you so much, 73.